Hello friends, I am Ankit Bhandari, in-house expert for physics, Ask IITians. So today we are going to discuss JEE Advanced 2016 paper, Physics, Part 1. So let's begin with the first question. A parallel beam of light is incident from air at an angle alpha on the side PQ of a right angled triangular prism of refractive index root 2. Light undergoes total internal reflection in the prism at the face PR when alpha has a minimum value of 45 degree. The angle of theta of the prism is. So this is a very simple question of ray optics where we'll be applying simple laws of ray optics and a little bit geometry. So let us consider this slab as PQR. This is our theta angle. So according to the question, this is our ray of light that is coming, and this is angle alpha, which is equals to 45 degree. Now this ray is refracted, making an angle R, and here it undergoes total internal reflection at point C. We consider this point as A and we extend this line over here and we call it point B. So this is our point A, B and C. So now since this is angle theta, this angle would be 90 minus theta. So definitely this angle would become 180 degree, since it is in a straight line. 180 degree minus 90 minus theta. So this becomes 90 plus theta. So refractive index we know that is n equals to root 2. So first of all, using Snell's law we get sine 45 degree upon sine r equals to root 2 upon 1, where R equals to 30 degree. Now we know that for internal reflection R1 would be greater than equals to 45 degree. So in triangle, ABC, we get R plus 90 plus theta plus 90 minus R1 equals to 180 degree. Let's see how is it coming. This angle R, this angle 90 plus theta, and this angle is 90 minus R1, where this is our 1. Okay, so solving this equation we get R1 equals to theta plus R. R we know the value, theta plus 30 degree R1. Now we know that R1 is greater than equal to 45 degree, so theta is greater than equals to 15 degree. So the answer of this question is A, 15 degree. So now moving on to second question. In a historical experiment to determine Planck's constant, a metal surface was irradiated with light of different wavelengths. The emitted photoelectron energies were measured by applying a stopping potential. The relevant data for the wavelength lambda of incident light and the corresponding stopping potential V naught are given below. So we have lambda as well as V naught values. So simply writing the equations for the energies, we know that for such an experiment we get EV naught equals to hc upon lambda minus phi, which is the work function. So we'll simply put the values of lambda and V naught and try to get the value of h. So putting the value, we have hc upon lambda, that would be 0.3 into 10 to the power minus 6 minus phi equals to 2e. This is our equation 1. Equation 2 becomes hc upon 0.4 into 10 to the power minus 6 minus phi equals to 1e. This is our equation 2. Now subtracting equation 2 from equation 1, equation 2 minus equation 1, we get hc 1 upon 0.3 minus 1 upon 0.4 into 10 to power 6 equals to e. So from here we get the value of h, which is equal to 6.4 into 10 to power minus 34. So our answer is B. So now let's solve question number 3. A uniform wooden stick of mass 1.6 kg and length L rests in an inclined manner on a smooth vertical wall of height h, such that a small portion of the stick extends beyond the wall. So this is our wall of height h, and a wooden stick. This is our floor. This is a wooden stick that has a length L, and that L is definitely more than h. So this length is L. So it says that reaction force of the wall on the stick is perpendicular to the stick. That means this is the reaction force, N. The stick makes an angle 30 degrees with the wall, and the bottom of the stick is on a rough floor. The reaction of the wall on the stick is equal in magnitude to the reaction of the floor on the stick. That means this would be equal to N, the reaction force by floor on the stick. Now we have to find the value of H upon L as well as F, the friction force. So friction force would be acting somewhat over here. So first of all, let's calculate some of the parameters that we'll be needing during our calculation. Let us consider this as A, that is the length till which the stick is touching the wall. So this A equals to, how will we calculate A? So in this triangle, H upon A equals to cos theta, simple trigonometry, equals to cos theta, and that is cos 30 degrees. So A becomes H upon cos 30 degrees. Now resolving these forces N, so we know this is 50 degree, this would be 90 minus 30, that is 60. So this would be again 30, so this angle would be 60 degree. Simple geometry. Now this would be n cos 60 degree, and this would be n sin 60 degree. Why we are resolving this? Because this we will be needing later. So the weight of the stick would be somewhere over here, and it would be mg at the center of mass. So resolving this mg, we get this would be angle 30 degree. So we have mg cos 30 degree and mg sin 30 degree. Now once we are done with this, let's see what we can do about forces acting over them. So now balancing torque about this point, so let us call it A. So balancing torque about point A, we get N into A equals to mg sin 30 degree into L by 2. Okay, so this is how we balance the torque. So we get an equation on solving this. We have 2nh upon root 3 equals to mgl by 4, putting the values of cos 30 degree, sin 30 degree. Okay, now balancing forces in both vertical as well as horizontal direction, vertical direction as well as horizontal direction. So for vertical we get n cos 60 degree plus n equals to mg. Solving this we get 3n by 2 equals to mg, where we get the value of n, 2mg by 3. Now balancing the horizontal forces, we get F, that is the frictional force, equals to n sin 60 degree. We can see it over here, this F would be equals to n sin 60 degree. So F equals to n sin 60 degree, this becomes, putting the value of n, 2mg upon 3 into root 3 by 2. So F comes 16 root 3 by 3. Also putting this value of n in this equation, we calculate the value of h upon l. The value of h upon l equals to 3 root 3 upon 16. So seeing our option, value of h is 3 root 3 upon 16 and f is 16 root 3 by 3. So definitely our answer is D. So now let us solve the fourth question. A water cooler of storage capacity 120 liters can cool water at a constant rate of P watts. In a closed circulation system, the water from the cooler is used to cool an external device that generates constantly 3 kilowatt of heat. The temperature of water fed into the device cannot exceed 30 degrees Celsius. An entire stored 120 liters of water is initially cooled to 10 degrees Celsius. The entire system is thermally insulated. Minimum value of P in watts for which device can be operated for 3 hours is. So this is again a very simple question. We'll first calculate heat generated in this device in 3 hours. So we'll try to calculate this heat generated in device in 3 hours, which will be equals to 3 into 60 for converting hours into seconds, and this would be multiplying it with the power, that is 3 into 10 to the power 3 joules. So we'll get this value of 324 into 10 to the power 5 joules. Now we calculate that heat that is used to heat the water, to heat the water that is present. So this becomes Ms delta theta. So this would be 120 into 10 to power minus 3 into 10 to power 3. 120 is the liters. For mass, calculating mass, we are just multiplying volume into density. So 120 liters into 10 to power minus 3 for converting into meter cube, and the density we know, 10 to power 3 kilogram per meter cube. So this is our mass into the value of S is given in the question, 4.2 into 10 to the power 3, and delta theta is change in temperature, that is from 10 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius, so that is 20. So solving this, we get 100.8 into 10 to power 5 joules. Now heat absorbed by coolant will be equals to P into T, which will be equals to heat generated in device minus heat used to heat that water. So this would be heat generated in device minus heat used in heating water. So we have these two values. Putting the values from the above equations, we have 324 into 10 to power 5 minus 0.8 10 to power 5. So we get P into T equals to 223.2 into 10 to the power 5. This is a very simple question. You just have to put the values into right formula so that you can get the answer. So P into 3 into, also you have to be careful about units. If you will not convert hours into seconds, then definitely the answer will be wrong. So now from here we can calculate the value of P, which becomes 2067 volts. So again the answer is 2067 watt, that is B. So friends, now let us solve the fifth question. An infinite line charge of uniform electric charge density lambda lies along the axis of an electrically conducting infinite cylindrical shell of radius r. At time t equals to 0, the space inside the cylinder is filled with a material of permittivity epsilon and electrical conductivity sigma. The electrical conduction in the material follows Ohm's law. Which one of the following graph best describes the subsequent variation of the magnitude of current density at any point in the material? So this is again a moderate level question. So let us consider the infinitely long line charge, and let us take a cylindrical medium that they have talked about. Okay. So lambda is the charge per unit length at any instant, and we consider that lambda naught would be the initial charge density. Okay. So now since this would be the conducting medium, so we'll take an elemental cylindrical object, like this is the element that we'll take. So at any point, electric field due to this infinitely line charge would be, we know E equals to lambda upon 2 pi epsilon r, where r is the radius. Now we know current density J that would be flowing through it would be sigma E. So J becomes, since we need to find J as a function of T, this becomes sigma into lambda upon 2 pi epsilon r. Now we know I equals to dq over dt equals to J into A, that means current density into area, and this becomes sigma into lambda upon 2 pi epsilon r into the area. So area of this cylindrical element would be 2 pi r into L. So 2 pi r, this would be the circumference, into this L. So this becomes 2 pi r into L. Now we know q will be equals to lambda L. So we can put over here q into lambda L upon dt equals to minus sigma into lambda 2 pi epsilon r into 2 pi r L. Now you may think why I have put a minus sign over here, since the charge is decreasing. So we are putting it a minus sign here. Now solving this, we get lambda, solving this equation, we'll get lambda equals to lambda naught e to the power minus sigma upon epsilon t. Now once we have this equation, we'll put this lambda over here. So we get J equals to, we'll get J equation of this kind, J naught e to the power minus sigma upon epsilon t. So from here we see that our current density is varying exponentially, so the graph would be somewhat should vary exponentially, somewhat like this. Okay, so J as a function of t, current density as a function of time, graph should be like this. So let's see our options. So A would be the correct option. So friends, now let's solve the sixth question. A transparent slab of thickness D has a refractive index N as a function of Z that increases with Z. Here Z is the vertical distance inside the slab measured from the top. The slab is placed between two media with uniform refractive indices N1 and N2 as shown in the figure. So here is our figure. This is N1 and this is N2. A ray of light is incident with angle theta I. So this is angle theta I. Let me draw it over here. From medium 1 and emerges in medium 2 with refraction angle theta F. So this is our angle theta F with a lateral displacement L. So which of the following statements are true? So in order to solve this question, we can follow one of the mathematical approach. So what we'll do is we'll consider two mediums. Instead of, since they are saying this, the refractive index is varying as a function of Z, so let's say we are considering this is N1 and we consider two strips medium N0 and N0 dash, and this is our N2. So now we'll see how a wave would go, how a ray would pass through these mediums. So this is theta I, it will undergo some refraction over here through this medium, then it will go under here, and finally this will come out. Okay, so finally it will come out over here. So this is our angle theta F. So this would be our angle theta naught. So again this becomes angle theta naught. So this angle is theta naught dash. So again this angle becomes same. Okay. So what we are trying to show over here is that we'll apply simply Snell's law, and we see that N1 sine theta I equals to N0 sine theta naught. Now we know N0 for this case. Now for this case we can write N0 sine theta naught equals to N0 dash sine theta naught dash, and for this boundary we can write N0 dash sine theta naught dash equals to N2 sine theta F. So from here we get that N1 sine theta I is equals to N2 sine theta F. So we are getting this result for our special case where we are considering two different media. Now if we have these infinite media and the thickness of these would be reduced such that it would be a function of Z, such that the refractive index would be a function of Z. So if we generalize this case, we can see that this relation for every case N1 Ni sine theta I will be equals to N2 sine theta F. So definitely for this case as well, for case where N is a function of Z, we will have that N1 sine theta I equals to N2 sine theta 2. So D is the correct option. So definitely C is wrong. Now we'll see about the lateral shift. So again, we'll see. We'll try to generalize from this case only. We see that this we take as L1, this we consider as L2. So applying simple geometry, this we'll consider as D1, this we'll consider as D2. So we'll see that L1 upon D2, from the figure we have tan theta naught c, tan theta naught dash, and L2 upon D1 equals to tan theta naught. So doing L1 plus L2, we get D2 tan theta naught dash plus D1 tan theta naught. Okay, so this L1 plus L2 is the L, that is the lateral shift. So from this equation we can see that L is dependent on theta naught dash and theta naught, and which definitely will be dependent on nz, that is as a function, this function. Okay, so the value of theta naught dash and theta naught will depend on this function nz. So we can say that L is dependent on nz, and from here we see that L, there is no function of n2 over here, there is no n2 over here in this equation, so we can say, definitely say that L is independent of n2. So both A and B option is correct.